Okay, I think we can start. We have a nice intimate group here. My name is Ira Lesser. I'm a psychiatrist at Harbor UCLA Medical Center and the Geffen School of Medicine. So thank you for participating, and I think thank you in advance for anything that you share during this session. So the first confession I have, okay? This is confession number one. I didn't know anything about NMO before a month ago. Okay? Okay, so if this was if you were having like tickets that you had to pay for to come in, you might ask for your money back right now and head out the door. Okay? Okay. So that's when I want, so everybody in this room knows more about it than I do, about NMO. Okay, so that's fine. I'm hoping to learn. On the other hand, I've been a psychiatrist for a long time and worked with lots of people with mood disorders, anxiety disorders, lots of chronic illness. And I think there are some commonalities amongst people who struggle with chronic illness in terms of mood and in terms of what they need to do to achieve some wellness. So I'll speak from it from that point of view. Okay? So I have a bunch of slides that I don't have to go through. I can go through some or all. I would much prefer this be a give and take kind of a thing where you share stuff with each other and with me, because it's my opportunity to learn. So real informal, okay?
Can I ask you a question before you
start? Absolutely.
Dr. Lesser, your opinion of NMO, what do you think about this disease? It's from what I've read.
It's not from any other. As I was reading it, I was incredibly moved by how difficult it could be for the person and their families. That the unknown about it, the uncertainty about it, just strikes me as something that's very hard to deal with. And so I was really moved by that. And I spoke a lot with Mike Yeaman, who's a good friend of mine. We had lunch, and and he was telling me about it. And the other side, I must say that the organization, the foundation, and what they've done in this conference is really quite astonishing. I go to lots of conferences and lots of organizations, and the professionalism that I see here, I don't see it in very many other places. Yeah. So okay.
Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. So, and please continue to ask questions. Okay, so let me tell you what I'd like to talk about, and we'll see if we get through these things. So I want to put up some personal accounts that I've gotten from the net. You have your own personal accounts, you could share them. Then talk a little bit about emotions and feelings that one might experience having this disorder. And then a little bit about differentiating those feelings from what might be a psychiatric disorder that either occurs as a result or occurs because lots of people have psychiatric disorders. When to sort of distinguish between them, when to figure out what may need additional treatment. And we'll talk a little bit about the treatment and then strategies for wellness. And when I talk about wellness here, it's not wellness in not having the disorder. It's sort of how to deal with the disorder, how to take steps to achieve whatever you can achieve despite whatever disability this might entail. Okay, so right from here, I guess this was from the net, and you could read it, I don't need to read it to you, but what I got from this is the difficulty with losing independence and needing to depend on somebody as a difficult part of this disease, as it is of many chronic diseases where somebody has been able to take care of themselves, and then for whatever reason, they no longer can do that to the same extent. And this loss of independence and the need to be dependent, to ask for help, I think could be somewhat difficult. And that's so we'll talk about that as we go along. So that's one, excuse me. And the other has to do really with relationships, that none of us live in vacuums. And relationships are among the strongest things that we have towards wellness. It's one of the protective factors for a lot of, for depression, for suicidal thinking. So being in relationships, but this can put strain on relationships as well. And so that's something else that I got out of looking at some of these things. So if you're willing to share, What are some of the emotional reactions or responses you've had for those of you who have the disease, or for those family members or who sort of live with people? You're willing to do that? Please.
I'm a caregiver for my wife for the past 10 years. And
Hi, how are you guys? My name is Jesus. I'm a caregiver for my wife for the past 10 years. And I always say that we live with NMO, but NMO is not our lives. Something that I noticed in the beginning, that we stayed for 3 months in a hospital, and I was sleeping on a chair, and I had so much energy because I wanted to, for her to be well. And I noticed that. I felt like, wow, I mean, I can't sleep only for 3 hours, 4 hours, but I still have the energy to be here, and I want knowledge. And I started searching online, and I started talking to the doctors. That's something that I experienced. And thanks God, I've been able to take care of her. I've been able to be with her all the time because of the type of job that I do. But lately, after 10 years, I'm feeling like, wow, I'm just like, I'm feeling tired. You know, I gotta take care of myself and worry a little bit about myself because I have to be there for her. Lack of sleep, or feeling like I need my time. I need a little space for me. Even though I do it, you know, I have my coffee with myself in the mornings and listening to music and things like that. But I'm noticing the changes and starting to notice them.
Yeah. Okay. Well, thank you very much. And part of what we'll talk about towards the end with steps towards wellness applies to everybody. It applies to people with disorders, without disorders, to all of us. And so you're right. You're defined as more than just a caregiver. You have your own needs. Everybody has their own needs. And it's important because the less that those needs can be met, the less successful one is as a caregiver. It happens to physicians. It happens to therapists. When we're feeling so depleted, it's hard to be useful to somebody else. And so the question is, how do you get recharged? And the recharge may be different for every single person in this room. What recharges you? Anybody else willing to share?
Yes, I'm a caregiver also, and I guess what I see, my wife has had NMO for about 3 years, a little over 3 years, and it's just the difference between the mood swings. She was quite the active hiker sort of individual all through college. In fact, didn't get her driver's license until she was well in her 30s because public transportation or whatever. So when she lost the ability to use her legs, it was very depressing for her. And what I see is especially the mood swings that go on when we're at a Costco store or whatever, where there's lots of hurrying and running and moving around, and she's having to use the riding cart. She goes through a very low period after that. On the other hand, she's been attending a swimming aerobics swimming class, and I see her come out of that very elated, feeling like there's at least something that she can fight against and can see and feels real good about herself. So I see the either end of the spectrum there in those mood swings.
Okay, great. Thank you for sharing that. Yeah. Anyone else?
Hi. I'm the grandmother of the patient. She has experienced a lot of situations where people don't understand the disease. And so they assume that because they lack understanding, they assume that what she's telling them isn't real, or that she is being dramatic or whatever. And so it's this constant problem of having to try to deal with people that don't understand, who have and no motivation, even though you tell them what the name of the disease is, no motivation to
examine it,
research it out. And then at the same time be trying to fit in with all your peers.
Sure. Yeah. That's tough. Yeah. That's okay. To not be validated, you know, for what you're experiencing is terrible, and particularly for somebody young who's trying to fit in and stuff like that.
In all honesty, too, she has really become a hero in my eye. Mm-hmm. I'm her grandfather. Mm-hmm. I've asked God more than once to hand this to me. Mm-hmm. Give it to me.
Yeah.
I don't know if she knows that. I'm not going to look at her because I won't be good if I do. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But I will tell you this. She's a fighter. She's one that when she does end up in the hospital, she's the charge of the floor. Mm-hmm. And I mean that. Yeah. If it's one of the wonderful children's hospitals in Nashville, Birmingham, Alabama, St. Louis, Dallas, whichever. I do want to share this. She has a dad who's a preacher. He's a Southern Baptist by trade. He's also probably one of the most best regarded United States Army chaplains at Fort Hood. The Lord has already used this young lady. If you have any concept of who Jesus Christ is, he's used her and will continue to do so. She's the love of our lives.
Thank you all for sharing that. And it's wonderful to see the support that everybody has for each other. Okay, let me move along. So we do have... We're on a fairly tight time frame, so I'm going to move along a little bit, but I don't want to interrupt anybody, or if people have something to say, please, let's do that. So some of these, so the question is, you know, are these responses that you've talked about or others, you know, appropriate? Of course, most of them are appropriate. You know, it's a chronic disease, things are taken away, or they feel like taken away. So to feel sadness, to feel anger, to feel guilt, to feel a lot of things is totally appropriate. But sometimes the stress of having something like that sort of almost morphs into something more than that. So something that may be sadness, which is a normal human reaction, can become a more serious kind of a thing, like may become a depression or may become an anxiety disorder. And at that point, and it's a little hard to know when that point is reached, but it has to do with when that those feelings affect functioning. So the sadness becomes so severe that it's hard to get out of bed in the morning. It's hard to do whatever activities you used to be able to do. And that's when one needs to think about, is there something additional going on, and does that need additional treatment? So these are some of the responses, again, that I've gleaned from the literature and that are not all that uncommon with other chronic diseases. There's the sadness, and which can move into feeling depressed or feeling hopeless about the situation. The anxiety and uncertainty, when you asked about what I've learned about it, the uncertainty of what comes next is very, very difficult, because it affects your planning and how do you look forward. That's very difficult. Anger, both in terms of why did I get this, or why did my spouse, or why did my child get this, you know, who are you going to be angry at? It's not easy to be angry, but people have those feelings. The feelings of guilt, of being a burden, so that the independent person who now has to rely on people, they themselves may feel guilty that they have to do that, feel badly about it. And certainly fear, and lots of fears of worsening, of the paralysis, of blindness, of having another episode, of the unknown is a major concern. Sleep problems, which I think are probably universal in this disorder. Weakness and fatigue. Some people that I've read talk about slower thinking, that their cognition is not quite as sharp as it used to be, being less productive. And certainly it can, as any sort of trauma and crisis does affect families, and it can affect it in different ways. The family could come together and be strengthened by it, or there could be families that are sort of have more difficulty struggling with it. So relationship problems certainly can be part of it. You mentioned the mood swings. That's clearly a part of it. and they can be minute to minute, like you said, Costco's terrible and swimming is good, or they could be on a more sustained kind of a basis. It could be more on a sustained basis where the downs last for days or weeks, and maybe the ups are a little too up. And so one needs to think about that, because that in and of itself can be a disorder in addition to having NMO. None of these are instead of. So when I'm saying there may be another disorder, it's not that the NMO isn't real, it's really something else. It's in addition to that. And I'll show you some numbers about that in a second. All right, so let's talk about just depression in general. So in the general population, okay, at any given time in the general population, maybe 5% of women, so 1 in 20 women at any given time, probably have enough symptoms to qualify for the diagnosis of depression. Not just sadness, but the diagnosis of depression. It's a little lower in men. Some people say it's partly lower in men because men have more alcoholism and substance abuse, and they mask it, right? Which is probably true. As a way of not recognizing it, they mask it with alcohol. In the lifetime, so that's in any given time. So lifetime, those numbers increase. So maybe for women, up to 20%. So that's 1 in 5, okay? And for men, maybe a little over 10%. And depression in and of itself typically comes and goes. It's what we call a recurrent disorder. So if you have one episode, you have a 50-50 chance of having a second. If you have two, you have a higher chance of having a third, et cetera. Now the studies that are in the literature on the rate of depression in NMO are somewhere in the 30 to 40% range. Now these are done different ways. Some are with direct interviews, some are scales, so it's a little hard to know. But even if you take the lower number, you could see that it's significantly higher than in the general population. So depression is clearly part of this. And I don't have it on there, but one of the studies talked about that in that depressed population, a significant number of people have suicidal thoughts. That it's so bad that they have suicidal thoughts. And that can be an emergency. So that is something that when we hear somebody who's depressed, it's always, always part of that evaluation to talk with somebody directly about that. The notion that, oh, if I ever mention that, it'll put the thought in somebody's head, absolutely untrue. There's zero evidence of that. There's actually more to the other side, that sometimes talking about it helps it not happen because somebody feels more understood. We could talk about that in a little if you'd like. Okay, so given all that, and given that large range of emotions that people have, what do you do to try and take control of this? Okay, so if there is true depression, there are ways of treating depression. Depression can be treated through medication. Antidepressants can be very effective. And there are psychotherapies, specifically what we call cognitive behavior therapy, or CBT, which is a very specific kind of therapy that helps people look at the kind of thinking that they're having, helps them examine their thinking, helps them sort of stop negative thinking. So that if you sort of say, I'm so depressed that nobody will ever talk to me, nobody likes me, whatever. And a therapist could say, well, let's take a look at that. You have these friends, so they like you. Let's look at the sort of the evidence that you're telling yourself is the truth. And it's a very effective treatment for people with chronic disease or with depression without chronic disease. Now, some of the treatments for NMO, I know a lot of people are on steroids long term. So steroids in and of themselves can cause really significant changes in mood in either direction. So that some people who take steroids for a variety of reasons may experience depression. Other people may experience getting revved up. And in dramatic cases, we've seen from the psychiatric perspective people who've been put on steroids for a variety of things who actually have true manic symptoms. They become manic. They really are revved up, they don't sleep, they start having strange thoughts or whatever. That's rare, but steroids in and of themselves can do that. And so if somebody's on that, that may be the reason for it, and there's ways to try and go around that. As I said, one always must be concerned about suicide, suicidal thinking, in somebody who's depressed. And the best way to deal with that is for somebody to directly approach it. It may not be a family member, it doesn't have to be, but somebody, a counselor, a clergy person, a therapist, whatever, to really honestly say, if you had thoughts about wanting to hurt yourself or take your life, what are you thinking about that? How might you do it? That's part of every evaluation that we do with somebody who's depressed. Do you have the means at home? Do you have a weapon? Those are kinds of things. For anxiety, similar things. There are breathing exercises that can be taught. There's another workshop on mindfulness. Mindfulness, which I have a slide in a sec, is a wonderful technique to just sort of center people. It sort of comes out of a Buddhist tradition of just sort of breathing and looking inward and slowing the world down and being centered. And it really is a tremendous anxiety reduction. No medication, no side effects. And so that's something. There are antidepressants which work for anxiety. There are other medications. Medications all have side effects, so one may not want to do that as first. But again, one thinks about, at least though I think about, the more severe the symptoms are, the more that they interfere with functioning, with what you want to get done, the more you might want to consider additional treatment. So CBT we sort of talked about a little bit. Mindfulness, again, and if you're interested in that, I would suggest you attend that seminar, that discussion, because it's a tool. It's a tool that you always have with you, no matter where you are. You could take a few minutes and just sort of recenter yourself, and it could be very, very effective. There's a lot of things that are sort of outside of the realm of traditional medicine, so not medication or whatever, and these are along there. So massage, yoga, or Tai Chi. Actually, there's data on Tai Chi, which is a Chinese movement kind of thing, that there are major changes in the immune system when people practice Tai Chi. My colleagues at UCLA have done this with older depressed individuals, people over the age of 65 who are depressed, not with chronic disease. And not only does the depression get better, but their immunological function improves. Because mood and the immune system are tightly tied in. Nobody quite understands why, but there is a connection there. So if you improve your mood, or if you improve your immune system, you're likely to improve the other one as well. And these are not specific, none of these that I found have been written about in NMO. So, I mean, it's not that do this because it's data on, but these are just in general kinds of things that you can do to enhance your own wellness. There are herbal remedies. So they're not, they're herbal medications, they're not manufactured. Doesn't mean they don't have side effects. People think, oh, it's natural, but it's not necessarily true. They may have side effects too. But these are ones that have been talked about as useful for depression. I put the last one on there because nobody really knows. I mean, in other neurologic states, the use of medical marijuana has been helpful. There's no real trials. The only thing that it's really approved for by the FDA is for cancer, as an adjunct to cancer chemotherapy, and an HIV. But people use it for lots of things. You know, I'm not saying you should go to do it, but it's just something to think about. And when we think about wellness, wellness has many, many dimensions. So it's the emotional wellness we've been talking about. I mean, financial, I mean, that is a big issue for people, obviously, with the finances, both to achieve your medical care as well as other things. Social, spiritual, so in true thinking about achieving wellness, some attention may need to be spent on each of these little things. Okay, so what are some steps, some concrete steps one could take? Well, I mean, being here today is one of the major steps. Having a support group, and like I say, that I've been to lots of other organizations and read a lot of stuff. I was telling Mike before that I've never quite seen the degree of professionalism and support that this organization has amongst each other. I mean, it's really quite touching to see that. And that, so that the network that you have, the online forums that you have, the support groups that you have, really very, very important. And as I say, support of whatever kind it is one of the key protective factors for longevity. When people look at who lives really well late in life, the biggest thing for that is having good genes. The second good thing is not being medically ill. And the third thing is having a social network. Okay? And that's the only one of those two, three things that we could impact. We can't change our genes. We can't not have medical illness. But we can do something about our social network. So we could try to do something. Certainly spiritual and religious supports, we had a testament to that. And again, that could be in an organized religion. It doesn't have to be. It could be some other spiritual, just something that you sort of have a belief in. That could be useful. Addressing the interpersonal conflicts, which are going to be there. I mean, that's just the nature of people being together under stress. There's crisis. There's a trauma. People may have some conflict over that. So to try and be open about that, to deal with that, is another step towards wellness. Clearly, things like exercise, healthy diet, things that you know about. There's another workshop on nutrition. Breathing exercises, as I said, yoga and Tai Chi. And then there's this concept of resilience, okay? So resilience, this is a wonderful slide I found. Fall down 7 times, get up 8. Okay? It's sort of not giving up, bouncing back. Young people tend to have more resilience than older people. And that's true of bouncing back from trauma, bouncing back from medical illness. That's just the way the body is. So let's talk about resilience. So a definition might be a person's ability to withstand stress and catastrophe, to survive in the face of adversity. So you could be resilient to many things, to medical illness, people who have other kind of traumas, assaults that they may have, or natural disasters, earthquakes, hurricanes, fires, things like, how do you bounce back from that, okay? Being able, another way is sort of more colloquial, to roll with the punches, okay? To take it and then figure out what to do. Now for a patient with chronic illness, like an NMO disorder or other chronic illnesses, it's really to overcome these feelings that are going to be part and parcel. The grief that over what you've lost. Lots of people, you know, you have functions that are lost. And when we lose people, we grieve over them. It's the same kind of thing as when we lose function. We may have to grieve over losing the function and then figure out how we're going to go beyond that. And being resilient doesn't mean that you don't experience emotions. It doesn't mean you're going to be a robot. It means you're going to experience the emotions. You're going to try and understand them, where they're coming from. If they're beyond what you think is usual or should be, you might then get additional help. And then you're going to figure out how you're going to go beyond that. Ways of increasing resilience, similar to the steps to take for wellness. Increase connections with others in your world. Big, big thing. Try not to see the crisis as insurmountable. It's a crisis. Maybe you've been there before. You can manage it again. Accept that change is part of living. Change for the better or change for the worse. That's nothing that we have control over. Take some actions. You know, whatever steps you can take, whether it be little steps and make a goal, achieve it. You achieve a little goal, say, wow, I achieved the goal. Rather than say, well, I didn't get this far. If you keep saying, I didn't get this far, it continues for you to be sad and depressed. If the goal is to get here and you made it, wow, celebrate that. Okay, so make the goals realistic. Find meaning, make each day meaningful, etc. So these are the kinds of things. Try to keep things in perspective. And to the degree possible, take care of yourself, whether you're a patient or whether you're a caregiver. Because as I said, caregivers who are depleted and demoralized and don't have time for themselves have a hard time giving. It's the way that the world is. It's not a fault of the person. It's just the way it is. So replete yourself, recharge yourself, et cetera. Okay, so what should you expect from the healthcare team? Well, I think you have, you know, the support of this organization is wonderful, but I think you, should expect for people to validate you, not invalidate you, not say, oh, come on, you know, you're exaggerating, or, oh, come on, it can't be that bad. That's not a good healthcare provider. And if you have a healthcare provider like that, I'd find another healthcare provider, just because it's just not helpful. I think you should think about if things are beyond what you would expect, is get a consultation and see whether there is something else going on or whether that should be addressed in some way. Certainly, you know the sources of information and the support groups.